obsession with anything that comes in a jar. Jam, compote, marmalade, jelly, the list goes on and on. And so I wanted to make a typeface that would be suitable for especially rebranding and packaging. So at first I had a pretty good idea of like what I wanted to use it for and kind of the size, you know, like handheld size, but I didn't really know what kind of style I thought I wanted to go to. So for the first week of the program, we looked at a lot of references from, well, Jean-Claude's personal contemporary library, and we visited a lot of public libraries in France. And I kept on getting, I kept on getting attracted to the same kind of styles, these kind of fat, extra bold serif typefaces from the early 1900s, as you can see. And I thought that they would be a kind of a good starting off point to base my typeface in, because they have this really like thick weights that would look yummy and juicy, I guess. So the first thing that I did in my exploration process was kind of trying to figure out what kind of serifs that I wanted. So from my references, I kind of figured out that there were two main kind of approaches to making a serif. So one is kind of this rectangular shape that are rounded, and the other one is also rounded, but more of a triangular shape. So I sketched both of these out, and I showed it to one of our first guest critics, Neil Summerar. And also another exploration I did was with the lowercase a. So the rest of the letters, kind of, I was not sure about how they would feel, but depending on how I structured the a, the mood of the typeface slowly changed. So if I stayed more close to the reference material from the early 1900s with a high bar, big hole, it gave the typeface more of a retro feeling, versus if I rounded everything all out, then it would feel more childish. So I tried to find a happy medium. So Neil Summerer was like, I like what you're doing here, so let's try to find a happy medium. So I kind of decided to merge the rectangular and the triangular shapes together to form the strip serif that was kind of like straight and then going to kind of triangular shape and then kind of rectangular right at the bottom. And these are my final ink kind of sketches that I used to base my first digitization process on. And then I showed this to the next critic, Andrea, and she said, well, these serifs remind me of, you know, elephant feet, and then she did this kind of stomping motion. So it kind of got me thinking, and she also mentioned that what I was doing with the typeface was kind of familiar already, it has been done before. So she pushed me to think of what it could be that could push it more forward to be my own typeface. So first, I got rid of one elephant feet, so now there's just one elephant foot, and it's kind of, I changed it to a more organic shape that's flaring outwards, that gives it a little bit more of a softer vibe all around. And so this is kind of, you know, I started, this is kind of to show that I was doing work outside of the office as well. And then this is kind of my explorations on interpolating between different weights, trying to find the perfect weight to form my understanding. So I'm happy to introduce to you Mirabelle, five versatile ways for all of your gourmet needs. So the key characteristics of this typeface, as I said, are these kind of organic feeling drop triangles and microcosmos. They're not completely rounded and they kind of drop into this shape that I kind of evoke a natural feeling more than something super structured. And this is one of my favorite glyphs and also a glyph that I had a really hard time doing, that I actually got from one of my source material from work. And I kind of like how it turned out. So Antonio, who was another guest critic, said, well, I was asking him basically, oh, should I keep this because I don't know if it's working, but he was like, keep the fox scale. So I'm happy how the fox scale turned out. And so Mirabelle comes in five different ways, black, gold, medium, regular, and light. And so this is the main way that I work on Mirabelle black. Can see that I worked on a lot of black critics, which was very new for me, but a lot of Europeans in the program helped me to get them just right. Mm-hmm. And so this is the slightly light version, gold, and then medium, and then regular, and then light. And when you put them all together on a page, they are surprisingly pretty good for long lines of text, because I guess the forms are pretty traditional. And so this is kind of full on the bottom, and you can see that it is very beautiful, also both gold and texts. And so I was pretty happy with where I was at this point in time, but Jean-Claude law was pushing me to go on even further to kind of explore what typeface can do. So it was my squash class. And I was like, this was very new to me because I have never really considered them before, so I had to go back to sketching and to the first drawing board to kind of try out what kind of shapes would work with the rest of my typeface. And then this is kind of my first attempts, and Eric from Balkan said they look like they're trying to do ballet at their desk. So I kind of like toned it down and like flirted more out, simplified a little bit, and I'm happy to say that now Mirabelle comes with a set of more fine squash crafts for you to use. And the squash crafts are great for packaging, branding, and everything, but if you wanted to do like a wedding invitation, then you can use them too.
Looks like the most of it. I think I was thinking the anatomy of letters as the anatomy of the human body. And I kept exploring more, drawing more letters, creating a lot of contrast, drawing different strokes, drawing different strokes, and creating shapes that maybe could work, and realizing that the more flatty shapes and the more extreme shapes might have worked alone, but when put in a lot of letters, it started getting a little bit all over the place. This was more exploration. These were the letters that I scanned that I eventually started to trace on, but the result from this changed a lot. The second point I got when I showed this type of work from Andrea was it doesn't look like a typeface yet, which for me, in other words, meant it looks like shit. This is what I eventually finished, sort of my specimen. And the challenge here was to create all paths that related to the style of the lowercase and making something that was a lot more fluid and brushy. And that's what I struggled with during this entire process. Some of the details to look at the letters was the way the brush comes into the letters. So the internals of the letters and the how it ends very pointy, and the sharp edges of the contours that I want to draw on all of the letters. And then on the last day, Xavier said to me, and then I asked him, really, just be honest with me. And he said, I mean, it looks okay. It's a better version of a and this is what it resulted in. I did a lightweight, regular, and bold. And the last thing I worked on was the bold, very different style of typeface that created an interesting contrast between the low color and the bold. And this is the result of that title.
Text.
Oh.
Okay, that's much better.
do calligraphy to try and find the skeleton of my typeface. And I wanted something with the angles of the black letter, but with rounder shapes as in our own typeface. And it took a while, and I was feeling a bit lost, and my first critique with Samar, he told me that you will either succeed or you will fail. And I was into the TypeParis program, and I thought, okay, if I will fail, then at least I will learn a lot, because I was super excited about everything we were doing, so I decided to continue. So here are the first shapes that I drew. I scaled my calligraphy that I did in a small size on paper, and I scaled it, drew on top of it, and this is what came out. And when I drew it digitally, it looked good and great, like each letter to me, okay, this can work, but together, it didn't really work in a system, and that's very important when I'm making a typeface. So Andrea Tinas, she was talking a lot to me about rhythm and DNA, and that my sketches, they were like, all the shapes were going in different directions, and it didn't really work together as a system, so I would need to work on that. So here is the first step that I made, and it's with Roman capitals, and it didn't really feel like they fit for the rest of the lowercase. So what I needed to do to make the rhythm work was to, as you can see here, there are a lot of diagonal lines, and I needed to make them more stable. I have less diagonal lines and some horizontal lines that work better when you set the text. So I redrew all my capitals so they work better with the lowercase, and I made them narrower than a Roman set, because with the lowercase it didn't really work with the Roman shapes. And it works well for setting small text, but also it works well for headings in larger size with a lower contrast bold version. So here you can see all the five weights that I have. For my reference photo that I showed earlier in the presentation, I tried to set up in a similar setting just to show you that even though it's not a complete black letter, it still works in the same way. You can have a manuscript, but it will be easier for the AI to read if you're not familiar with black lettering.
More human. our life more fluid and less mechanical. That's why Art Nouveau typefaces was a main inspiration of 60s, 70s psychedelic designs, and that's why it's so attractive to me. So creating Psycho was a long and dusty road with more questions than answers on it. Because I couldn't copy much, I couldn't steal much solution, and I had to figure a lot by myself with the help of our talented instructors. And I had to try a lot of different shapes, forms, and weight distribution systems before I found something that might work. I didn't have any particular reference from which I could copy, so I started my Art Nouveau exploration with sketching and calligraphy, and I've tried different type of contrasts. And different type of letter shapes. So this is my first set of letters I came up with in sketch form to get an idea of typeface. And here I used a rotation of the nib, which is very usual for the Art Nouveau typefaces. So you're using a nib tool, but you're rotating it all the way. You're not consistent with an angle of the tool. But as long as I did more and more sketches, I realized that this system doesn't work because some letters look really ugly inside of this system. So this is my second set of letters where I decided to switch to an oblique axis. So I'm not rotating my tool anymore, but I'm still using Art Nouveau letter shapes. And this is something that shows the system how I've tried to be thinking about the weight distribution. I've tried to look up on the letter shapes as a stencil so I could understand where I need more weight, where I need less weight, and so on. And after even more sketching, I finally found a very weird weight distribution that I decided to stick on. It's basically a mix of main stem shrinking in the middle and oblique axis that has nothing to do with the stem shrinking. So stem shrinking is just a stylistic solution, just a stylistic decision. And since the very beginning, I've cared a lot about the white space in between the letters. I really wanted them to be connected, to interact with each other. I really want all the contours have something in common, something to go on inside. So now my typeface have some kind of rhythm. And it's clearly visible in long texts. I started to design this typeface from bulk. And I've been struggling for weeks. When the rest of the group been like finishing their third master, I still didn't have a full glyph set. Because I couldn't figure the letter forms for days. I've been twisting and tweaking, trying a lot of different solutions. Because mainly letter shape solutions very depend on my weight distribution system. But during the last week, I switched to the light because Jean-François really asked me to do so. And the process got so much faster, everything has gotten easier, and I've been able to finish my main glyph set. Surprisingly, this thing looks fine in a text. So my letter shapes developed a lot and changed a lot from the first sketches to the last digital files because on the way I realized that some Art Nouveau shapes, they just doesn't work. For example, like this S or like this P because it has so many extra white space on the right. And after I had my two masters, I interpolated them. So I had calculation is magic. thank you. And can I say my thanks? I'm really grateful to SODA organization for letting me be here. I'm really grateful for all the students in this group for their support. I wouldn't make it that far without you. And I'm really grateful to my instructors for being patient with me. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Mika, and I'm here to present my typeface Botnia. Botnia started as a... I was inspired by this Finnish architect and designer Alvar Aalto's work and his idea of this kind of organic modernism. So instead of looking at other typefaces, I looked at the shapes he made in his work and his philosophy more about this, like this kind of like the brief of my typeface. So compared to the other, most of the other modernist designers, he preferred some kind of more like this organic feel to this work. And also for it to be really functional as well. And if you are not familiar with his works, this is some references I had, and I just wanted to like look and really see how he uses the shapes and if there's some interesting parts that I can use in my typeface also. So these are the really early sketches of my main key letter forms that I started with a pencil sketch. But still trying to maintain some sort of like a dolly look to give it more human feel. And then move to the next phase to have more refined sketches with a tracing paper, trying to still maintain the look and feel of the my first letter. So I started actually by scanning these and scaling and tracing the very first sketches. And then the first digitized letter forms, you see it's kind of quite similar to the my sketches. And this is the final typeface, the letter form from my final typeface. So it has a bit more higher horizontal rhythm and really like high connection, volume, device construction, open numbers, and very large edge height, and then this kind of a similar extensive feel in some of the letters. So just trying to keep it like a really strong horizontal rhythm and open counters and the legible construction. So if we compare the letter shapes to the artist work, this is what it was actually my sort of like a main inspiration of this work. And I really wanted to look at the shape of this work. And maintain some key characteristics like this. Botnia comes in 5 weights. Light, regular, simple, bold, and black. And I drew some of the light design as well. And here's the basic character set of the light version. And then the full character set also. So again, some comparison with the author's work. Trying to get the feel of how it matches the author's shapes also. Just an example of this. This is actually from Paris in the 37 to an expo. And here's an example of the bigger text, of course. And that's all caps also. So it works quite well with the rendering and with the bold and italic, making a more like a more flavor to the typeface.
Music and I wanted
my typeface, if you like, could be used for it. So I introduce you to Donna, is the name of a Venezuelan composer. I decided to fuse my calligraphy drawings, like the swoop and the stem of the N, the little flag, and the ascender of the B, and the kind of like a brush style of the C, with the old style of the Garamond, which has a very narrow E, or the A, and the crossbar of the E is a little higher. And a little bit of music, but you know, I still wanted to dance a little bit. So P and a lot of the connections between the stem and that curve, it turns very quickly, it goes very quickly, just like Gustavo Dudamel. So like, look, Mom, I made a typeface! And you can put it in a magazine! So Dudamel is really the pure synthesis of everything I've learned in typeface and type design and of my process with this course. And so we did our regular, then tried to do the bold, and then interpolated everything in between, because now I know what that means. And then I tried to do the song, which is, you know, under construction. So I went, no, no way. Well, we printed our specimen, delivered our files, and if you know Xavier, he took a look at it. He said, oh, this is too bold. This is too bold. We need to fix this case in here. This one's not good, but it's difficult, I know, I'm sorry, but we need more contrast here from here. So I still have a lot of work to do. But of course, I'm just like, oh my god, it never ends. But I'm super happy with where
hi everyone, I'm Shreya, and I'm here today to tell you a little bit about my typeface, Extra. So this is a very unconventional definition of extra, but if you use it as slang, you know it means something that's really over the top and like excessive, and it's just doing a lot for no conceivable reason. So I'm a graphic designer, I'm not a typographer, and this brief actually emerged out of a branding project. So when I had to do the branding, my first instinct was obviously not to design a typeface from scratch. I tried to use an existing typeface for the branding of a design studio that I work at in Bombay. And a lot of our favorite projects are usually murals or street art or environmental graphics. So I thought, okay, stencils might be an interesting point to start from. But most of the stencil type that I came across had this very industrial and rigid look that didn't really capture the vibe of the place I work at. So that's why I began to draw extra, which is something I wanted to translate between like a really playful typeface that you use for branding and stencils that can actually be applied in street art. So the first thing, like, I didn't really have a lot of references to go by. So I started by sketching some words. And this is what I got. I wanted it to be really punchy and like bold and, you know, have a very over-the-top vibe. But this looked really good on Instagram. But there's just a lot happening. You notice all the counters are going in different directions, there's like too much dancing going on, so it would have been a pain to turn this into a typeface. And at this point when I was kind of stuck, Matthew would introduce me to this iconic course that says typography is a beautiful group of letters, not a group of beautiful letters. So it's like not every single element in the typeface has to be, you know, doing everything at once, as long as it's just them together does it. I mean, I understood where he was coming from, but I still had a little doubt. I was like, no, I still want to tilt the axis. And then Jean-François introduced me to an even more iconic quote, and he just said, you're not doing this. So, after a lot of sketches, like all this happened in basically one weekend, I could go from what you see on the left, which at 5 weeks I can see is a disaster, but at the time I really loved. And then I tried this compromise that I did with its writing, but then finally I ended up going into vertical stress and something that was a lot more constructed. It seemed very toned down here, but now that the typeface is actually here, I can see it works much better as a system. So some of the features of this typeface are really short ascenders and descenders. This does two things. When it's being used as a display typeface for just short words, it can be like it gives a nice quirky look. But the extended X sign also gives it an easier legibility when you're trying to read it in chunks of text. It has asymmetrical thread serifs, so I mean, I did have to let go of that, the crazy dancing counters, but I retained them in some places. And the wavy serifs give it like a rhythmic kind of texture. It has like pretty close apertures, rounded corner. Now, the whole point of my typeface was to create a stencil, and this was supposed to be a starting point. And a lot of changes actually happened when I started making the stencil, because I realized if I want to use it as an actual stencil, spray paint into it, use it to actually make tangible stuff, a lot of the stuff from the earlier typeface is going to have to go because it's really sharp and there are too many corners, so it's not really going to do justice. So I ended up turning the serifs into thread stems, which was quite a big change. I rounded the corners, and generally this one has a lot, much more friendly look, I would say, than the previous one. The family as a whole has five different weights and a stencil variant that's been under construction. These are my results, and these are some of the applications. So I was really excited to get here. Like, this is what I always wanted to do with the typeface, like use it and have fun with it as a graphic designer, because that's what I do when type is intuitive, like something I have a lot of experience with. But yeah, I mean, like, it's far from perfect, but I had a lot of fun applying it in different contexts, and I think that is one of the things I wanted to achieve with this project. This is a very different vibe from what has been used so far. Like, the lighter weights translate nicely into something a little more serious with a slight amount of work. But mostly, yeah, it's used like in the louder context, something you can have a lot of fun with, something where even the content has to be a lot of fun, filled with puns. And this is something I actually want to do, like use the stencil in street art, use the stencil in branding as an actual stencil. So that's something I want to be working on in a while. About TypeParis, I've heard the quote, it's a marathon or a sprint, but TypeParis is both. It's you're sprinting a marathon. I mean, it's 5 weeks, and you're gonna have to learn how to sleep for 5 hours every day and still come to class and make something. But it's just been an incredible experience, and for that, I think I have mostly rest and students to thank, because 2 days before I came here, I had a surgery back in India, and I literally couldn't even sit up. And then being here, the energy was so contagious. Like, I actually found myself staying back after class and going home and working, and it's only because everybody else was in the same boat. So it's been amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. His presentation is on there.
Thank you. Thank you.
Shreya. Are you nervous? You did a good call, man. What time? To go? Tomorrow? In the midnight? No, it's okay. You have time. It's time.
Miquel,
they have to get the microphone.
Okay.
So I was looking this round approach, round typefaces approach, but that to be used in a more serious context. But the problem is that the typefaces that I wanted to make it were already exist. So we had to find the process to find new shapes and to find new shapes that were resemble to that, but that weren't drawn yet. So I'm going to talk about the process because for me it was the most important part. So we jump from Sao. We jumped from Sao, we found many different type specimens, but this one interested to me the most because the typeface looked like it wasn't finished so that I could complete it. So having this as a base, I started with a calligraphy pen. I started sketching above over the letters, the skeleton of that typeface that I liked. And once I had the skeleton, I started to draw over, but those were like 2 or 3 millimeters sketches, so I had no much precision. So everything was looking bobbly and roundish, and shapes were not defined. But when I scanned them at big size, like interesting things started to happen, like all this roundness that I was looking for finally happened. So yeah, these are some of the ideas that I had in my head, like having round terminals and this. So this was a really interesting process because when I worked at this size, and now big size, had another look and feel, and now I could start tracing over. So yeah, this is what the first main sketches started looking like. And this was one of the first letters that I started sketching. And you know, when you got the very first one and you have the stands and the contrast, you just can go on. This is how the first master look. The lowercase, we see this big round serifs, bold terminals. The uppercase afterwards, which always comes much easier. And yeah, at this point of the project, I like it how it goes ways, but I need to try the typeface because you can see how the typeface works until you work with it. You know, you need to see it playing and if it fits what you're trying to feel. So I started to play with some fake posters, just playing a little bit to see how it feels, if this was the approach that I was looking for. Once I have this, which was what the idea I had at home, how do I work in a master? How, if I have these big bold serifs, how they behave in a thin space? So this is what they have, and you know, you just have to change the shapes. The bold is a bold, a light is a light, and they have to resemble, but they don't have to be exactly the same. So sometimes you have to take decisions, you know, I had to sacrifice some things in order to find another vibe. You know, what I said at the beginning, those typeface, Windsor, Bill Sands, Souvenir, their extreme weights are very different, but they don't feel familiar, so this is what I was looking for, and I didn't care if it didn't look exactly the same. This is how the second master started to work on, like, working the lightest as I could. The uppercase where you can see like what I was trying to make like this formal context. You can see it in the Q, the tail of the Q, the K, especially the R. These tails, I thought they added like more serious to the stuff. You know, just play with stupid things. I don't know. Just trying to see if what I had in my head was working in the typeface. And you know, the cool part, the cool thing about design is just you design two weights and then magically you get like all the weights that you want. So this is like the full set that I'm working on. I have added like caps alternates, arrows, and I'm still trying to expand to fit all the design that you need, because and you know, just trying what I said earlier, just trying to play a bit with the typeface and see if it feels kind of the vibe. Just trying to make some tests for the typeface, and if you know, it can feel like really different this to this, but it also obviously there is a part of graphic design about how you compose this, but there are very different styles. And you know, obviously this typeface was very wide. Has very wide proportions because it was intended for display use. So, okay, I thought just make a condensed version. This is the stage that I am working now. I'm just trying to find to make it work the letters. So it's not finished, but I like how it feels. You know, it's the condensed version. I think it looks better for more poster design. Not as much for branding, but you know, magazines, this stuff, or you know, just playing. This is the full set that I worked so far. From then, it's still not finished. And in the future, I just want to expand to bold condensed, because I think it can be harder to make. So yeah, I can learn more. Obviously, when I did the thing condensed, I was aware that it was much easier than making a bold condensed. I was tricking myself, but yeah, in the future I want to expand it to the bold condensed. And so far, I got here. So thank you for everything, and thank you, guys.
bit of a part of my project. So my typeface is called Kolobi, and so when I got here, I was super excited. I just wanted to learn, and so I decided that I'd probably create a text typeface because it's really hard to do, and that's when you get to learn a lot. But then also there was like a little bit of homesickness, so I wanted to have some sort of like Indian influence. So these are some of my references, and these movie posters, they are by this filmmaker and graphic artist called Satyajit Ray. You should probably look his work up, and it's all in Bengali. And that's like some, that's a typeface, that's a Bengali typeface that was part of my reference. So I wanted to create a text typeface that also had this very bouncy, dynamic and expressive quality. It's a contradiction, but yes, so that's what I set out to do. And so I started out by just tracing all these. I don't speak right or read Bengali, so they were just like really nice, interesting shapes to me. So I started out by just tracing all the shapes from all my references, and like any project that I do here, I started with any detail. So I started to look at all the details that I could incorporate. What I didn't want to do was just blindly imitate. I wanted my Latin design to have the same personality as the Bengali references. So yeah, maybe just blindly copying which quotes was not the way to do. So I started by doing a little bit of column chain calligraphy because that has a lot of bounce and dynamic quality. And then, you know, we selected a few letters, we drew them up, and then we started to draw. When you scale them up and when you start to draw it, that's when the fun part begins, I guess, because you can add all these details that you want to. That was the first part, and then it moved to this, and then this was a constant thing because there were a lot of details that I wanted to incorporate in my typeface, but in type design you know that you have to create your values, and that was like a big learning curve for me because you can't just include everything in one typeface, so you need to pick and choose what you want to do, and at this point I really like to thank all my knights for being super supportive and maybe just putting the equation with me. So that transforms into this. This is the regular way that this is the main book set that I have. So some of the features that I incorporated from the Bengali calligraphy and the letter examples are the horizontal stress. I wanted it to have this brushy quality, so that's the serifs, but then it also has the different stroke ending. And the curve tensions that give it a little bit of bounce. And so yeah, I was able to experiment with interpolation and a few weights, which is a work in progress. This is the text, the texture. Yeah, so I just wanted to talk about the learning, what I got to learn, like a few main lessons. So when working with bilingual lettering or bilingual letter shapes, you can't obviously just copy paste everything because the tool that is used in each script is different, the angles, everything are different, so I just picked out like a few key details which I can use to make sure that both the designs have some sort of similarity, like the weight, the contrast, stress, and obviously the lettering details. So I just like to say that it's been a huge learning curve and I'm really grateful for this opportunity. So yes, that's it. Thank you.
Same construction but different way. So
my idea was I'm here and I'm learning, why not explore something different? So why not create a type family that contains, instead of in a way, different kind of contrast? Right? So I had a same construction and I explore different kind of contrast. About so the kind of contrast that each weight needs to have, the amount, but also the orientation of this contrast. But let's talk about the process. My idea, of course, it was to base the all the process and all the typeface on a reference, because I think that it was important to have a historical reference, and I decided to, we are in France, in Italian, so Bodoni, why not to take a Dido typeface? So, because at the beginning, my initial reference was a specimen from Nebbiolo, but with the help of Jean-Francois, we decided to explore other options. So we started this process with the collection, the milieu of life with Jean-Francois, sorry, but in French. And we started looking at the, at this book and try to understand better the shape of, and the texture of this, this text. And the process was to enlarge a lot the letter, the texture, to discover and understand better how this typeface works. And it was surprising to discover that if you look at the texture, you think immediately that they have a super high contrast. But then I enlarge each letter and I try to trace it, the general shape of each piece. And I discovered that So this was the process to, first of all, take the original grief, enlarge it, trace it, and then understand how the letter works. I do this this kind of process for each leaf, and of course I sketch a lot to figure it out which kind of direction take and give to the project, because I want to avoid to do exactly a proper revival of so this was different kind of exploration, because in class with the suggestion of Mathieu, Mark, they were telling me to try to explore, to stick in sometimes a lot with the source. But then also when I talk with the first guest, Neil, he told me, yes, it can be interesting, this kind of the solution, but don't try to stick a lot with the source. But then in class, Jean-François was completely the contrary, because he every time told me, you have to respect the source, Claudia, with his face. And a little bit hard, and I don't know how to...
You have glasses.
Then, the second week after the exploration, I continued to explore the different options. And the first solution was to insert in the letter a little bit of corner on a little bit of the angle on the side. But she suggests me to push more this kind of direction. But then again, you have to respect the system, Claudia, always with this attitude. So I was a little bit lost. But then I need to deliver the project. And I decided to go for this kind of system. Have on the, this kind of angle on the corner and make it more visible. So, by the fact that the idea was to design also a text typeface, if you resize a small size, this kind of sharpness would be less visible. And another system was to have different kind of distribution of weight. So, apply these kind of things to all the other beef. And I did this for the text,
the display, and the reverse. Also, I decided to keep this kind of shape, for example, in the C, and try to maintain also in the reverse, because usually it's not a solution that is applied. So this is on the regular, on the display, on the reverse, and it's an interpolation of the three masters that give this kind of shape. And Grinnell was the idea of using the name of the word I'm saying here, and also because if you remember at the beginning, the G was a really, really cool gift, so it was nice to put it aside. And this is the text, the regular version of the gift. The text will give to the text, but even if you enlarge it, it's also a nice shape, a nice texture. This is the display, because after that I complete the regular, I try to work on the different kind of contrast, so this is the display, beautiful set. And this is the reverse, that is still in the process. So I the three masters are the regular, the display, and the reverse. And I decided to understand what's happening in the meanwhile. So between the regular and the display, I interpolate to create a semi-display. Between the regular and the reverse, I interpolate to create a semi-reverse. And also, the most interesting result was the Grinnell's reverse and display. So here you're going to have a look of the interpolation between the three masters. And after the first data less meeting, I had also the approval from Eric, that is also a great achievement. And yes.
So next.
And especially those translated from the Chinese language, so they can get
the typeface can give it the text more organic and calligraphic texture and suggest a sense of Chinese culture. So the project started with like humanistic Latin calligraphy, like the first week as everybody else. But then we moved on to tracing paper, so we started making design decisions, so like how the series would look, how the proportions would be, how the curves gonna look like. So one day Jean-Francois came over and looked at my typeface and said to me, it's very funny because you are the first person we have had in the program from mainland China that just letters you draw clearly very Chinese. So that comment really struck me in many different ways. So first of all, I did grow up like in China doing like Chinese calligraphy. My parents sent me to do calligraphy because I had horrible handwriting. But then after many years of calligraphy, I still had horrible handwriting. But then I guess I picked up some calligraphy skills and I just didn't realize like they really remained with me. But also in the past I've had people like saying to me that the letters and things I draw like it was very, very Chinese. But this time I thought I was doing Latin calligraphy, but then in the end they still look Chinese. So I found that very interesting. So I decided to take these projects further to develop a full typeface from it and explore the balance between Latin and Chinese and their connections and the boundaries between each other. So after a lot of more iterations and drawings, so we look at like how these drawings are looking Chinese, what elements make them look Chinese or Latin, then how much we could push further without making it look like cliche. So then we reach this main alphabet. So it's the NCR regular weight. So some of the features that are influenced by Chinese calligraphy. So first of all, the letters have a very wide proportion. So you know, Chinese letters are very square characters. Then also the serifs. So in Latin, the serifs, usually there are attachments to the main stand, but in Chinese calligraphy, we do have like entry and exiting strokes, but that seems a little bit longer would be a separate stroke altogether. Then also there are very high contrast within like a single stroke, and also there are very fast transitioning from the thin parts all the way to the thick parts and then back to the thin parts. So this are influenced from the Chinese brush calligraphy. So after another messing in the back, so I got a full family of five different weights. So at this point, I started to explore some other possibilities because I said I wanted this typeface to be used in literature and books. So so we started solving some other problems. So first of all, is there too much contrast for text? Because my letter forms are very contrasty, so we did some tests. So here's the typeface in the regular ways. So when shrinking to like 8 points, it does look very contrasty. There are a lot of space and things going on, so it's a little bit hard to read. So we decided to go in and adjust the contrast. So have a lower contrast version that is especially used for text. So here's the regular drawings, and here is another adjusted for text. So then I got a second stylus text from regular to black. Then another issue is this typeface too wide for display, because like it's for like powers and other spaces are limited. So maybe a little more condensed version would be good. So started exploring other forms, so for example this is really accept that. So it could be just display that make this some more slow and elegant feeling, but then with a condensed version it's more like impactful and more it's much stronger. So then this is the condensed regular weight. And then another master I got like more bumps in the condensed in different ways. Then the instructors were like, "Hey, So, because like for text, to setting text, you need text. So I started to explore JavaScript in the reference of La Obelina by Ludovico De Lanetti. So because your lessons are wide and round, so maybe something that's more sharp and condensed to be like this contrast. So I started to draw the italics and trying to match texture to the other keyboard. So here's the zooming. Then one set with regular weight and the italics, you can see a clear contrast between the two. Then here's the italic regular alphabet. And then another master. So italics from italic from regular to black. So at this point, Valencia has four styles, and each available in 5 weeks, and it can be used for a variety of purposes in literature and books. So like very strong, impactful cover, big letters, or very elegant title page, or specific full text. So here's the zooming. And in the end, the name of Valencia comes from the Latin name of Tang Olive Tree, which is a species native to China. Then traditionally, this kind of plant is used to make Chinese calligraphy ink. So, and that's it. Thank you very much.
Paris, like looking all over and admiring every detail, every corner and every
Everything I see since I came. Second one is the dreamer. I'll show you then when we get there. The third one, the lost, like many of my mates that were lost at some point here. The pruner and the believer. So let's begin with the first one. I'm here in the best tourist post I ever had. This is at the museum, Jose. This is one of the places I got many of the influences, references, and also from other museums we've been through with the program. So looking at many many books, looking at many art pieces, there were many references of the letter forms related to plants, all these organic shapes, all these stems, everything was related to plants. So that really caught my attention as a designer and as a tourist also. So like walking on the streets, you can see details here in Paris and also in Lyon of what I was telling you. See like the plants, the leaves, the fruits, everything is seen in everywhere. So for people who live here, maybe that's nothing interesting at all, but for me it was like a real discovery. Even the ice cream of gelato has the same shape of the rose, so that was really calling my attention. And then also in the museums and the streets, I found all these Art Nouveau pieces that really try to reflect this shape, this organic shape, these curves that you can find on nature and all the petals, the stems, the flowers, and all that. So at that moment, I was beginning to sketch, and I had all these, not all these images, but I felt like I was going to the right way. So as a dreamer, I started like drawing many things and full of details like ornaments, and my typeface is gonna have the look of steam or the look of petals. So I was having fun drawing. I really did many things. This is just a part more exaggerated. So I was having fun. I did some maybe lettering work, I don't know, full of details, full of shapes and curly things, a lot of curly things. And just like many of my mates, we got heartbroken by Jean-François when he told us that's not a system at all. It's way too far from system, so clean the shapes, clean a lot. So, yeah. So I had to clean it, I did it. And after our first critical thing was with Neil. Yeah. Neil told me, go this way, try Vila. So Jean-François told me, you don't have to do Vila. You waste your whole day. So I found working with Vila, like doing the shapes with the brush, with a neat brush, I learned how letters work. Maybe, I know I have to learn a lot, but like doing it by hand helped me really a lot to make the needle skeleton. So then I become the pruner. I know I have to change a lot, I have to clean a lot. So I found some hope in this. It's not like a total loss. So I start to cut, you know, the parts that don't work like in a plant, so that the energy could flow, and then I could do something interesting with that, with my typeface. So I went back to basics, pretty much with the ductus, the tool, the simple tools, and trying to make all these shapes, all these things I saw on the streets, to make them simpler, nicer, but that they still look organic and natural. So I did some drawing with a pencil brush, with a pointing lid, with all those, and the way the ink flows really helped me to find some interesting things. So after many pages and many letters, I kind of got into this. This is the closest to my starting point. So it felt really natural because it looked kind of like my own handwriting, but I had in mind that it had to follow some kind of system also. So I went back also to the plants, you know, watched them like looking at them in a very deep level, and those shapes, simple shapes, I needed, they were there, you know, in the bottoms of the flowers, in the details of the leaves, little things, small things that nature had. Nature has, not the big decorated ornaments necessary. So I took these shapes and I put them in my letters. See, these petals and these simple shapes. It's a little bit cleaner, so you can see here. So after trying some stuff, I came out with this. This is like kind of my, there's light at the end of the tunnel, and this is the one I had. And then after thousands of clicks and erasing and doing, going back to paper and fixing things, I had some glyph files. I started to learn the program, so it was interesting to see this. And then the believer, once again. So I am glad to introduce you, like, yeah, this is my typeface. Will be a typeface one, it's not even close to finish. But it's going to be a type design system for a nursery plant and for other, like, business related to organic and natural shapes. So it could work. So it's developed for a display and text, maybe for packaging, social media, and tags for other purposes. So I think it accomplishes in some way what I was looking for, to be modern, to have some fancy shapes, elegant curves, organic shapes, and also ornamental drop tab that I try to do. This is the regular. The numbers are really nice because our dearest professor Matthew here helped me with them. That's why they're the best grades there. And this is the one I got to complete. There's also with the extrapolation, I did the thin version, and that's when I realized I have my mistakes to correct. And I did the interpolation to get the bold one, and I did the master for the black, so that was pretty much the process. This is just a way to show how they could work. I didn't really make many applications, but these are the weights and the way they could look. So since I'm talking about plants and fruits and all that, I like the one version from here to show that the roundness is also flavor. This is just some applications. We all have a pan au chocolat every day, so it's general language for us. And just I like that I can play with the letters, forms, and they are really bouncing and they glow. That's what I like. So this is my attempt to try to make a drop cap, really illustrated drop cap, like we've seen on the museums and the books. And well, Loretta is here to make a love, those perfect shapes of nature. And I'm here to keep learning and not designing. So,
a lot crazy state.
each time and teacher say me, please, it's too crazy, time the game. So for me it's really, really difficult because I'm so tired, really. So the real challenge for me was to separate the graphic design from the type design. So I had to go back to start again on more simple shape, more readable, more typeface. But for me, it was really, really, really boring. My goal at this point of the program is to find my ideas to shape on the state on the shape of my letter as nice and calm as possible. So I work. My first letter were passive. I became two white, regular and black, and after interferent white called up the rhythm. It is important to have a good contrast for a good reading of the information. Still for the rhythm and for the contrast, I use the same exercise with a sensory version and distance. So here is a complete alphabet with my uppercase, lowercase, and figures, numeral, and diacritic. My danger pick are together to be elegant and dynamic for presentation with little text like Muni, and as with many text. So, challenge taken up with my first typeface. It was a complex family with Swiss-T, regular, sans serif, display, and format. So, thank you so much.
And you can see that it's a mechanical typeface, but with some slightly curious and oblique ending. So yes, that one was it makes me like I found shapes. So I started sketching. You will see the ends. How I did an attempt to go to something stencil, but no, this was not the way. You don't have to tell me. You have to be boring. So let's go back to the first attempt. So from this end with more boring and more slight shapes, I started exploring, and you'll see this kind of word G E, but all was based on my references, so I was enjoying a lot drawing these shapes. And yeah, I'm to the conclusion that it should be something mechanical, very vertical. At the same time, my challenge was to find some organic shapes with these oblique diagonals that could give me some rhythm, always related to jazz music. I explore as well some capitals and light version. And yeah, what I will summarize my main struggles. So the high of the ascenders and descenders was kind of a fight during all this process, and I think it's not already decided. So yeah, I tried to find somehow how you see the bar of the F and D should be the same alignment or not, because you have very short ascenders, so it's kind of difficult to find the best solution. Maybe it's not the best solution, just trying the best. And the endings, again, how they... So the gray version was the first that I digitalized, and you will see that there is a lot of different angles, different alignments, so it's kind of messy. And even if the display typeface should be more calm. So we found the solution where most of the letters align the same line, except the R and C, which are more long because of the white space inside. So this is the color that the main weight of Locomotora creates. And more zoom. Some alternates like this white O to play a little bit with the rhythm. Some display samples. And as well, I tried to design a very thin and condensed typeface, which is not finished at all, so this is why you. This text is not very good. So you see that anyway, I have like very vertical shapes, but the weight is so small. And you can combine both weights, also with some white shapes. And this is the interpolation I did from the condensed pink to the condensed black. Some more samples. What we love. It's probably that.
Hi everyone.
So thank you so much for being here and seeing our presentation. Appreciate your time. I want to share with you what the process of how I went through this TypeParis for graphics and how I came up with the typeface that I designed. So it's called the Fillmore. Fillmore is a typeface that expresses the groove and cheerful spirit of music to a letter form. So I got inspired by a lot of music that is from the 70s era. And actually the name Fillmore is from a music venue in San Francisco. So this is the initial mood board that I came up when we were asked to send for a brief what you want to design for the typeface. I was initially want to design it for a branding project for Tiffany Music, where it's a production music record. They do a lot of production music for a lot of movie stuff, funky stuff, but modern as well. And on the right, it's something that is more of the look and feel that I'm looking forward to. And then on the middle here, I'm very interested with this poster, which is designed by Wes Wilson, who's also working for the Fillmore, which is the Fillmore auditorium that is based on San Francisco. And here are all the posters that they have. I think what's interesting here is because the way they created the shapes is not they're not drawing the shape, but they're drawing the counterpole to create the letter. So from here, I'm starting to look more on the 70s era kind of poster that probably inspired me from color, from feeling, from all the kind of expression that I want to show on my typeface. So a lot of funky stuff, a lot of and what I learned about all the inspiration that I get is again the use of the counterform, and it's very blocky, and sometimes they use optical effect, which is like a bell bottom, or how they use the contrast, and then how they play with all this kind of effect. It's also they have a lot of round corner shapes, which probably made from the hand brush feeling that can create a hand drawn and handmade kind of feeling. So from there, I'm starting to sketch a lot of things, just like everyone else, sketching. You can see that I played with making the shapes, blocks, and then just trying to touch, just making the counterform itself. And then everyone just like attracted to these small things. And Jorfosa told me that you probably want to draw small because you want to create, you want to make sure you have a blobby typeface, and then figure out about the counterform. But actually from the small typeface here, I'm just like tracing it from water display. So this is what I just traced it like on paper, make it small, and then trace it with a brush, big brush, so it's very bulky. So from there, like zooming in and then, like, just making it to see like how the contour shape work and then how the letter work. So here's the initial first sketch that I did from the small, and then zoom in and then like make it. Has this kind of like probably groovy feeling, has this kind of like blobby and then rounded shapes, but then like again a lot of feedback, blah blah blah, and then this is like the final sketches where before I went to digital. From here I went to digital, and this is what the first digital looked like, digitalized typeface. A lot of people come to me and then say, oh, it's cool, but it's not fun, but it's cool, it's cute. A lot of people say cute to me and I don't like it. So there's Andrea, and then during this one as well, Andrea Tins also come as a guest speaker. And then I was telling her, okay, I want to have like more groovy kind of feeling, more serious and not cute. And then she was saying that, oh, probably it's because you have this, for example, the zero is like having this, although it's playful, but it feels like an eye, and some of the shape is just not working. So it's also because I think, because she thought that it's in the middle, it's either go display or it's either go text as well. So what I did is just like, so she suggests me to make like a bell button, she suggests me like to make it either go more display or either just tone it down a little bit to go more text. So I ended up go more display. And if you can see, this is like the, just the difference is how it looked. And then I played with a lot of G, like this is the first G that I have, and then trying to simplify it to work as a system. Another G, but I ended up using this just normal G. Just because like when I'm trying to interpolate it with the light, there's a lot of white space on the light, and then when you see it on the text, it looks better to with the other text, with the other letter. So, again, a lot of sketches after that.
what the text would be, and then yeah, just a lot of fun. And drum rolls, please. And then I also really like how to play with the deck, not the deck, but with all the punctuations. And then just having fun with it, with the number as well. And then this is just like the characteristic of the typeface. You can see that there's like a dot dot dot, everything, the weight is, the typeface is on the bottom. And then from some of the part as well, you see there's this counter shape. If you realize on the first sketch that I did, it's wrong. But I ended up making it so, like, more rectangular just to fit with the kind of feeling that I want to go with. And then the heavy button serif, as well as, if you can see, it looks square as well. So, and then after that, like everyone else, I'm trying to make the extra light version. With this one, I've intended to make it more as a text version, so I remove all the effect, I make it just monoline, and make it very subtle. And here's how it looks like. You see in the actual line, the width of the bottom shape is like just the same as the other else. And then when I interpolate it, it looks like very bottom on the bottom. So here's how it looks like. You can see in the bigger one. And the G, I think the G works much more better than using the grid shapes. And just the color of the texture of how this looks like. And trying that?
No.
Also is working at smaller sizes. At first,
the letter forms that I drew weren't light enough. I wanted to explore the interpolation a bit more. So that's how it got a bit lighter towards the end. And then here's a little bit of the before and after of the calligraphy. Starting out, it felt obviously very humanist as we were drawing the humanist form, but I didn't want it to feel too old, so combining that with the Scotch-Roman proportions, widening it a bit, giving it a bit of a rounder feel, but also still maintaining that sharp counterform. And so next, Jean-Francois said, okay, you will, I did the Cooper program before, so I have a little bit of experience, but I still feel like a newbie in this type world. So he said, okay, I said, give me a challenge. He said, okay, you're gonna design a serif to sans variable font. Sweet Jesus. So I was trying to figure out, okay, how do I do that? I've never explored this sort of thing. I've seen the cool GIFs online. It looks great, but of course, if this plays, it probably won't. So we'll escape to the actual interpolation here. Everything looks fine until you actually go into the in-betweens. Some crazy stuff starts happening, especially within the right leg of the R. I'm not quite sure how to fix some of this stuff, and so instead of, you know, attempting to figure this out, I didn't want to waste a ton of time moving onward. I knew that it wasn't really working, and I knew that I had a lot more to learn if I, you know, continue with the project without this aspect. So you can also see how that happened with the A. With that ball terminal, it was definitely a pain in the ass, and everything in between just was not working whatsoever. And even some of these counterforms here, or the outlines, I mean, had to essentially lay on top of each other for the interpolation to somewhat look okay. Again, it sort of scrapped the idea, but it was a good learning experience. And so here we are, moving forward to the full family. It has about 8 weights, and I'll go back and forth real quick so you can see that fancy magic. We went from essentially extra light to black. And here, I'll leave it here for a second for you to just gaze at its beauty. A bit of that texture. If you want this specimen poster, there's some over there. I'm not going to take a moment. Here's some of those favorite glyphs. That A is pretty sweet. That dollar sign, that interpolation happening with the opening of the apertures in the dollar sign, I really enjoyed how that happened. And of course, my not-defined glyph, it's the best. Okay, and then we have a week left, and they're going around the classroom saying, okay, what more can you do, what more can you do? And he said, okay, you're gonna design a talus. I, of course, was very skeptical. I thought, no way could I do this, but in the day, I somehow managed to pull off only hamburger fonts, but at least it's enough to guide the direction for when I go back home to Phoenix. So I made some progression there, but of course, this is just the first pass, and there's a lot of work to do. So here's a bit of the back and forth there. Some larger letter forms so you can see those juicy details. So what's the future for Sweet Jesus? Well, first things first, it won't be called Sweet Jesus when I finish this thing. I'm going to take my sweet time finalizing everything. There's still an immense amount of work to do. I'm going to finish those damn italics. They will beat me. And I probably won't draw mathematical symbols because math's pretty hard. Alright. That's it. I miss you already. Merci.
Thank you very much for your presence, to give your time, to judge the typeface, to discuss a lot with us, to have compromise, to be sure, you know. The jury job, the usual jury job. This is really the end of the program. With this diploma, the diploma doesn't change anything. Yeah, the certificate, the diploma will not change. You have it or not, it will not change anything. I mean, the piece of paper. Everyone has the certificate and the diploma. what was important at the journey during the 5 to 5 weeks. And for that, it's incredible the moment we've been together during the 5 weeks. This moment, the human things we go through all together, it was incredible. Like, you know, last year, I recall about that, yes. Every year, it's incredible what happened. All of you try to express during your presentation the moment where you arrived. You don't know exactly what will happen, but you are hoping to go in a new territories that you have to discover during the 5 weeks. You surprise yourself every day, every evening, every morning. That's very intense. We change in the contact of each other during these 5 weeks. And for us, it's every year we change. We learn more about the human, how they are, and how the perceptions they have, and the new things they have to deal with. So this moment, it's a top thing. It's why TypeParis exists. It's not just to learn about type design or to learn about the serif. It's a moment we spend together. It's a moment where we feel the same emotion all together. And this is incredible. So thank you to be there for the 5 weeks together. You want to say something? You want?
I don't really remember what to say, but it was actually pretty impressive. I thought that. So we did, like Benjamin and me, we did the first year of TypeParis. So we were like the first timers in some respects, and it was pretty intense. We did the same sort of thing as you did. Went for 5 weeks, very intense course, and did I guess we had some pretty cool results as well. But we kind of feel that every single year, there's like it's getting better and better. It's pretty cool to see that. Yeah, like all of the projects are really cool. I really enjoyed all the presentations. It was actually a discovery for me because it's the first time that I see all the projects of TypeParis this year. And yeah, so we had a cool discussion. Yeah, it's congratulations, great work, guys.
Type design, it was almost 2 years the time to learn, so I'm very impressed, and I think it's also amazing to be able to learn in so short time. So I would like to congratulate for the work that you've done in so short time, and congratulate also for to question type design and type family, and to welcome you for your creativity. So I wish you the best.
Thank you.
First, thank you for showing us your work. It was an amazing amount of work in such a short period of time. So, as somebody said, congrats to everyone. And also, it was very inspiring. And like I said before, when I saw your presentation, I was like, "Oh, I want to draw." So you, I guess it's a good thing that I felt like that. So thank you, everyone.
Congratulations, you did a very good job. It was interesting, quite hard to judge also. It was only me, I would give you all congratulations to everybody. You deserve it. what cylinder and head it's on. We were a lot of churches. Yeah, so congratulations. I wish you the best to continue what you see in TypeParis. Try to keep it, try to continue what you learn. It's important to not stay here. Continue.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm very happy we had an external jury this year. It sparked a lot of interesting discussion for us. I think that's a lot of things to think about for us as a program and how we can progress even more in the future session. So thank you very much for that. And thank you all. Like, we know it's a hard 5 weeks for you, and you all like went along and went to 100% in the program. So we know how hard you worked, and we're very grateful for that. I also think all projects are great. It's very cool. I think I told you several times that, that it is always hard, but you just go faster with the experience. And you all of you already know what you did in the last week is like incredible compared to what you did in the first week. It was hard, but you went way faster. So keep designing, make another typeface. Like most of you said, oh, this is not finished. I need to work a lot more on it. Maybe it's true. I also think you should be very proud of what you achieved. It's a considerable amount of work, creativity, and quality. So don't be so hard on yourself. And sure, maybe finish these if you want, but you have no choice. You have to design another typeface now, and then another one, and another one. I'm blown away by what you've done in 5 weeks. I'm really scared to think about what you could do in a year or two or three. So please let us know what you do. We want to see what you do in the future. We are very excited for that. And one last thing, of course, keep doing type design. No matter what you do, there is always a way to build tools and design typefaces for yourself, for a client, for a foundry, whatever. But also, I hope, personally, I hope that everything you learn doing type design, myself and teaching type design, is applicable to many other things. So all the approaches you explore during these 5 weeks, please keep them alive when you do graphic design or music or car mechanic or whatever. But yeah, keep learning new stuff.
Yeah.
So the first one we call is Shreya Harihara.
Miquel, Vila.
Soo Kim.
Mélanie, the
best one.
Oh, yes, you have chocolate too. Yeah. Yeah, this moment is little special.
So I'm happy to say that the end of TypeParis. I'm sad also to say that the end of TypeParis, but it's not the end. We'll continue the party together, little more later tonight. So it was a pleasure to be with you during these five weeks, to receive your
application back in February.
To discover the portfolio, to be super excited by you when we discuss about your coming, when we had you on the base camp, when we are seeing you begin to have the first exchange of message, and when you arrive here the first day, it was a full thing for us. A big thing again this year, so thank you very much again. Yeah.